in, babe.
Welcome to Coco Caliente. You just started that without even asking. You weren't expecting that, were you? No.
So given the guest that we have today, I just wanted to talk real quick about what are the odds that we end up together in real life? Like, what were those odds before Big Brother?
Very small, because I would not be in Louisiana for anything.
Exactly. And I would never have come to Michigan. Like,
no.
It's not a
destination. Well, I guess New Orleans is destination, but it's not my destination.
Yeah. And they call Michigan, so something that I learned, it's like, a pass-through state or whatever they call it. Basically, nobody comes here for, like, let's say some type of tourism type thing, right? If you're in Michigan, or if you're driving through Michigan, or if you're driving in Michigan, it's because you're passing through to maybe get to Canada, or, you know, because even if you're driving up in the northern states, you don't have to drive to Michigan to get to New York.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Chances would have been very slim for us to ever even lay eyes on each other, although... You did apply for 16 and almost got on.
Which is another crazy fact.
You would have seen me because did you watch that season a little bit that you didn't make it and you were so close to making the cast? Or did you just like say, nah?
So I didn't watch it at all, right?
But did you see the cast?
I saw the cast and I was trying to find to see who took my spot or who got it over me, right?
Who did you think?
I have no idea. At the time,
I had short hair. Because there's always a long haired dude, and you had long hair on 18, which I think got sealed the deal. I would definitely want to see. Hey, who's better than me? Like, who took my character?
Yeah, and it was kind of crazy. Maybe it might have been like Zach Rance.
Oh, he was crazy.
It could have been like that type of.
He was so entertaining, but that could have been it.
Yeah, but it
who knows?
It was just one of those. I just think it's bizarre, because in what other parallel universe would we have ever met each other?
I know, and honestly, even meeting each other, I was just like, no, he has long hair. My past guys with long hair, they broke my heart. I'm staying away from him. So I like ignored you all season, except for we were friends. But then the fact that a year later, because even when after Big Brother 18, we would have never said we were going to end up together.
No, and I wasn't in the right place.
Right.
To be in a like long committed
relationship. And I could sense that. And that's why I just vetoed you right away, because I was like,
you don't have to use Big Brother terminology.
I didn't do that on purpose.
When we're talking about things that aren't Big Brother related.
Yeah. I just knew you weren't ready yet, but hey, you are now.
So it's just funny. I guess in saying that, it's just funny how the universe works. And with somebody that...
Because wait, not only did we... That was when they decided to bring me back.
Exactly.
Like, they even had to decide to have two girl returners.
And so what I'm saying in this, right, and this will segue right into the episode that we're about to have. Somebody that has a decision but doesn't realize the impact that those decisions have down the line, right? Because there's people in a room in CBS studios, well, maybe not CBS studios, but in conjunction, right, the production company and CBS all together working, and they're making decisions that impact people's lives down the road.
True.
And one of those people we have on the show today, which is Robyn Kass. She's the casting director for Big Brother.
Yes.
And she, at some point, made that decision, put me on the wall for that cast, and you were up there, too, in the cast, and it just kind of happened.
They do a puzzle piece. We're all puzzle pieces, and we're trying to fit
together. Yeah, and how many times did me and you come off that wall in the process of that season?
I know I came off for season 18 for a little bit, because they were worried about me, because I was, like, just getting out of a relationship.
Yeah.
And so they were like, ooh, is she going to be able to handle this again? So when I got back up there somehow.
So today's going to be a fun conversation. Our really, really good friend, Robyn Kass. We hope you guys enjoy.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello, Robyn. I was sitting there waiting for you to send me another number, and Vic's like, she means her number. I'm like,
Sorry. Yeah, my regular number. I just don't have... the best cell reception in my place, so I was giving you my landline, but hopefully this will work.
Did you just say, I'm sorry, I'm going to have you repeat this.
I know, landline?
Yeah, did you just say landline?
Yeah, you guys, it's a whole like California earthquake thing that I have that I can't get rid of, that it is like my number one, like, horrified terror in my life is going through another earthquake, since I've been through some big ones. And usually during earthquakes, you can't get through on cell phones. Uh-huh. So I have a landline, literally, because I am crazy terrified of earthquakes.
Okay, so for our listeners that are out there that might be under the age, let's say, of like 15 or maybe even 17, depending on, you know, how you were raised, a landline.
Describe a landline?
Yes, a landline is a phone in your house that's connected to a cord that goes through the ground and into the land, aka landline. And it can work without electricity depending on the type of phone that you have. So, I don't know. This is kind of antiquated technology that works in emergencies.
The funny thing is the other reason why I have my landline is because since my reception isn't great on my cell, I do so many like radio interviews and stuff that I always have people call my landline so it's clear and I don't have to worry about anything getting cut off.
That's smart.
Yeah, and that's why we do the FaceTime audio, because we've seen, like, if I just do a normal call, like cell phone to cell phone type of deal, it's just like, it sounds really bad. I don't know what FaceTime audio does, but it works really well.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm so happy to know when you wrote FaceTime, I'm literally like, that bitch. Like,
oh my God, no.
But we weren't seeing each other. Now I like put a hat on and a shirt on. Like all the things that I wasn't wearing before.
No, shoot. I meant FaceTime audio. I'm sorry.
You probably said that I just was mortified for a minute.
Well, as we're talking, you can go and feel free to take that stuff off because nobody can see you, so you're fine.
How are you guys doing? Happy holidays.
We're doing good. Vic is almost done with the State Police Academy, so I'll get my, you know, other partner in crime back. I've been pretty alone.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I mean, I did want to spend a minute congratulating you, Vic, and I saw the, like, before and after picture.
Oh, yeah.
That was crazy.
Like, what happened with the before picture? I don't remember. I don't know where that guy came from.
Congratulations.
Thank you. You look great. I know you've been working so hard, so that's awesome.
I appreciate that. And let's preface the before picture real quick here, because it is really bad. And mind you, in that before picture, I'm sweating, and I had done no exercise. So I think what happens is when you have a beard and hair, it makes you look a whole lot better. And then once you go bald and shave, you don't like the beard stuff, do you?
I mean, I like the clean cut look, but I do not think that has anything to do with the body.
Yeah, I don't know.
No, he had a couple too many beers, I guess the Midwestern food, and...
Too many board games, less gym. Yeah. So.
Well, you look great. I'm so proud of you. That's amazing.
Thank you. I appreciate it. But today is about you, Miss Robyn.
Oh, boy.
Kass. Okay. Yes. We're gonna talk about you, and because listeners may or may not know who you are. And people look up to us, right? Because, oh my God, they were on Big Brother. But you're the actual famous person in this mix, right? Everybody wants to know you because you're the one that gets us on that show.
Right.
I'm the matchmaker. So if they know you guys, know that I had something to do with bringing you together.
Yes. Yes. So yeah, let's just start from the beginning. Tell us a little bit about, you know, what you were doing before you even doing like casting stuff. And it's just kind of ironic that your last name is Kass.
I know.
I know.
The irony, it is my real last name. People ask me all the time, but yes, Kass is actually my last name. you know, it's funny, you guys, that but it's like I started in reality TV when reality TV started, the very, very beginning. So I haven't really done much of anything else. You know, I finished school. I didn't really know what I wanted to do with my life.
Where'd you go to school?
I went to Cal State Northridge out here. Mm-hmm. And if anybody knows the word Northridge, that's where the big earthquake was.
Oh.
So that goes to the beginning of our conversation and me being freaked out about earthquakes. Mm-hmm. But anyway. so I was working in game shows and dating shows, like sort of before reality TV even made it. And when reality TV first started, like the very first Survivor or Real World, which I would think those two are sort of, you know, the pioneers, the beginning of all of them. I think when reality TV started to kind of become a thing, they didn't know what types of people to hire because it was so new. And I was one of those few people who had like real people interview skills from my dating show experience and game show experience. And Big Brother 2 was sort of my first big reality show. And I think at that time, you know, it's people were still figuring it out. Like, is this a fad? I'll probably do this for a couple years and then it will go away. We were figuring out how to do the interviews. We were figuring out how to do the testing. And then, you know, obviously within the next few years, it just exploded. And I was one of the really fortunate people to be in at the very beginning. There weren't very many casting people. There weren't very many people who knew exactly how to maneuver through reality TV. And we were all sort of figuring it out together. And I just, you know, I really, really, really lucked out getting in at the beginning. And, you know, I started my company in 2005. Basically because of the overload of reality TV and getting, you know, so many offers to do shows, I couldn't keep up with them. So, you know, I've been really, really fortunate to sort of ride this train from the beginning and, you know, and making fun couples happen throughout the, throughout the time.
So Victor and I are going to be releasing our wedding date soon. And
we're engaged.
Yes.
We've been engaged
for quite a while. But we did plan, we did get wedding planners. That makes our job a little easier. And so soon we have to register, and we are registering on Zola. And we're also making our wedding website on Zola. Currently, my assistant and I are working on that. News to Victor.
I know. I've been so absent from this whole process, but I'm happy that there is Zola there to help make this process a whole lot easier.
It's easier. It's less stressful. So they do have, like I said, wedding websites, registries, invites, a guest list manager. It's all in one place. There's hundreds of free website designs. It's easy to create your own site in minutes, which is something that I'm doing so that way people can look where we're registered, where, how their transportation, et cetera, et cetera.
You can have a custom URL, which is really cool.
Yeah, that is super cool. Yeah. It's the highest rated registry of all time. So if you're a little worried about it not being like for you, it's the highest rated.
Yep.
There's free shipping and returns. There's free easy exchanges. And you get a 20% off post-wedding discount, group gifting, price matching. This is for all of your registering for gifts, experience, and honeymoon funds. There's so many things that you can do. Plus, you can make beautiful, affordable invites.
So to sum it up, they have everything. Yes. And they're one of the best, if not the best, at it. So
they'll help you collect the addresses and track online RSVPs, which is something that is, if you're looking to save some money, you don't have to put all those stamps on. You can do online RSVPs.
Yep.
Zola has helped 1 million couples get married. They'll help you too. So sign up at Zola, ZOLA.com/COCO today to get your free personalized paper sample. Then use code SAVE50 to get 50% off your save the dates.
Oh, wow.
Wow. That's crazy. That's Zola.com/COCO and use promo code SAVE50.
So when you were at first, it was just kind of a bunch of like, okay, we need people to cast. And so we're just going to get a bunch of people that have a little bit of experience in that. And then after that, it kind of snowballed to like, all right, well, you've been doing it for a while. I'm going to start a company and now we're going to let you kind of take the reins on this. So how did that transition work?
Yeah, you know, it was a really scary transition because I'm sort of the first person to branch out and start my own company. And basically what was happening was I was working freelance for so many years, which so many casting people do. And a show would hire me. I would hire staff, move into their production house like I did in the early years of Big Brother. And I could work on that one show. And when that one show is over, I would get other offers. I'd hop to another production company and another production company. And it got to a time when I was getting so many offers, and it was basically because there weren't that many people doing what I was doing. So, mm-hmm. I mean, every week I would have a show or two call me, and I couldn't because I was working in, you know, in a different production house. So after a few years, when I had, I guess, you know, a good reputation and a lot of people knew my name, I just went for it. And Gord, who I think both mm-hmm. of you guys yep. know, yeah. mm-hmm. who's my right-hand man, you know, him and I talked about it. And I said, what if we just go for it and try to do this on our own? And then we will be able to take multiple shows and have them in my own, you know, place. So I don't have to do one show at a time. So, you know, when we started, it was scary because no one else had done that. And I think production companies were weary about not having me in-house and seeing me every day. Mm-hmm. I think networks were a little bit nervous at first for the same reason. And after I was able to, you know, still get jobs and jobs were coming in and we were getting multiple shows at a time and making deadlines and everything was working, I think, you know, we just lucked out and we've been, you know, going strong since 2005. And now there's a ton of casting companies and a lot of people who are doing what I'm doing, definitely a lot more competition. But yeah, it was definitely scary and nerve wracking at the beginning, not knowing if people would trust us enough to let us cast shows outside of their reach and just kind of check in with them. And now, of course, it's so easy. I don't even have to really go into the mm-hmm. production company that much. Everything is online. I can send them edits. I can send them cuts. We can talk online. We can Skype. Like, everything is so accessible to my company that I think other production companies sort of enjoy us not being around because, you know, casting people, we're loud. We talk a lot.
What?
My office is very loud with a lot of loud people. And I'm something, you know, probably the production companies are like, "Woo, get them out of here. Get those loud people out of here."
Well, so, it's crazy because it seems like when you look at it now, it seems so natural, right? Like, oh, of course, they'd be in their own space. It's easier right. for them to do it. They're not in... they're not using real estate of this, you know, of this, right. of this network and doing all right. this stuff. And so, but at that time, such a novel idea. And it's like, well, I don't know. I kind of want you guys here all the time.
Yeah. The first, I'd say 2 years, you know, everyone says when you start your own company, it is terrifying. And it was every freaking day, just Gordon and I figuring out how things happen and insurance and billing and making sure that our deadlines are met and hiring people. And I mean, it's a big undertaking. And believe me, there's still times all these years later where we get shows and Gord and I sit around going like, how are we going to get this done? We need the best game plan and the best staff. So,
I didn't know Gord was
very fortunate.
Gord is awesome too. I didn't know that he was with you from the very beginning. So that's super cool to know.
Yeah. We were actually working on shows prior to opening, the company. Mm-hmm. We'd done a few. I mean, if you have any like listeners from like way back in the day, Gord and I met on a dating show called Elimidate. Some people might have heard of. I was casting and he was a production coordinator and we'd worked on a few shows together. And when this sort of came about, yeah, I mean, he knows how to put everything together. I would be, you know, I'm the creative person, but I would clearly be nothing without him doing everything else with my company. Everything has to do with him for sure.
So I'm a person of, I like information about the extremes, right? So what is, if you had to put a number on how many different shows that you've done casting for, and also what is like the most bizarre show that you've casted for?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. You know, the funny thing is, oh gosh. Number, I'm going to have to look at my resume. The thing is, we do also so many pilots. So, I mean, I'm sure we have cast in the hundreds shows that have actually aired on TV. I mean, gosh, I mean, there has to be 50 or 60 at least something.
That's a
and
lot.
Then, yeah, I mean, we've done so many shows. And then on top of that, lots of presentations, lots uh-huh. of pilots, and cable shows. And, you know, I had a show on Facebook. I mean, there's if you look down my resume, you'd probably recognize the name of some of them, but maybe not have seen them.
Yeah.
Or else you'll be like, oh my gosh, I remember that show. from 10 years ago. The weirdest show? Oh my gosh. The funny thing is, you know, so many companies call and, you know, the first conversation is them telling me the concept of the show and in my brain, just seeing if I think it's doable. Because some of the concepts are so crazy in my head. I'm trying to figure out what the best game plan is. And sometimes I'm like, I don't think this is like, this is a project for me, or I don't know how the heck to find these people. So I'm fortunate that we're sort of, you know, at the place where we can pick and choose. I don't have to take everybody. Yeah. Okay. I'm trying to think of the most bizarre show. You know, years ago, I did a show called The Swan. And it was kind of like Extreme Makeover meets a beauty pageant, where we had women from around the country who needed extreme plastic surgery. And not just like, hey, I need to lose a few pounds, but like head to toe, you know, problems in their life. And through this whole like extreme makeover, and they had therapy, and they had makeovers, like, you know, hair and makeup. It was turned into this big like beauty pageant thing. And I gotta tell you, that was really difficult to cast.
I bet. Who's willing to put themselves out there like that? Oh my gosh.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, really. And it's also, you know, I know viewers don't like to hear the word recruiting. You know, we go out and find people. But I mean, when it's a season one show of any show, that's how you find the people. I mean, people don't come to you because it's a brand new show. They have no idea what the concept is. Mm-hmm. And it's like, that's a show where you can't really walk up to someone and be like, hey, you look like you're unhappy from head to toe. Yeah, so it was the show ended up being pretty good, but that was a tough one. I'm trying to think of like weird ones that we've done.
That seems expensive too. Like
the
amount of surgeries and the hair and makeup people and probably dentists and all that stuff.
Everything imaginable. Oh. That show was definitely like before its time, I think. But it was a big hit. It was a big hit, but it was really difficult casting. And some shows, you know, like I love the big ensemble shows. You know, I love doing Big Brother. Mm-hmm. I'm really enjoying Love Island. And, you know, I like big dating shows where you can find individual people. But, you know, we do a lot of more serious shows. We try to find families and problems, and those, you know, the casting those shows, it's a very different avenue. And I use different types of people in my office who, you know, people who are better on the phone and really digging in and getting to know people and their lives and personal things about them. Mm-hmm. We've done it all, guys.
The holidays mean celebrations with friends and family. And Rothy's is a company that makes beautiful shoes for women and kids out of plastic water bottles.
I still can't believe that.
Because they don't look it at all.
No, if you would have told me that the first time you wore them, I wouldn't have believed you.
They are crazy comfortable and machine washable. They come in many different styles. I have the big cat ones, which is like a cheetah print with the pointed toe flats. Mm-hmm. They look very dressy. And they have ones that look more like sneakers. They have ones that, I mean, they have different kids ones too. There's so many different styles and so many different colors. And
so wait, let me hit you with that effect real quick, because I had to look it up after you said that they were made by plastic.
Yeah.
And by making their shoes using repurposed plastic water bottles, they have diverted 35 million water bottles from landfills already.
That's amazing.
That's crazy.
Yeah, so they're seamlessly knit using the thread made from plastic water bottles. They're comfortable, like I said, the second you slip them on, and there's zero break-in period with these shoes, which is something that, you know, your feet kind of hurt usually, but they don't with these.
You know what I like?
What?
Sometimes your feet get stinky, And so these these shoes you can throw right in the washing machine. They're machine washable.
So if you're interested in trying these Rothy's shoes, there's so many amazing styles available at rothys.com/Coco. So go to rothys.com. That's spelled rothys.com/COCO to get your new favorite flats in time for the holidays. Comfort, style, and sustainability. These are the shoes you've been waiting for. Head to rothys.com/COCO today. So a lot of our, most of our listeners are Big Brother people. So how is casting for season 22 going?
Yeah, let's get right into it. We don't officially start until February.
Oh, okay.
So I'm not really, you know, hands on just yet. Still in the tail end of Big Brother Canada, which I'll be doing through January. And then I'll get my staff in-house for Big Brother 22. But I will say the applications have already started coming in. I peek at them every once in a while. Yeah,
Is it open all the time for you to?
No.
Oh,
no.
Okay.
So we'll have like a deadline. I would have to look and see what the deadline is. But it usually opens on like the last episode of the season before. That's when we announce it. Mm-hmm. So at the tail end of Big Brother 21, that's when promos will start. We'll open the application so people can apply from, you know, from that point all the way till the end of casting, which is usually like, I don't know, April, May, maybe like May or June. I have to look and see. And I do get a lot of questions of when is the best time to apply? Should I apply at the beginning? Should I apply at the end? To be honest, it doesn't matter. Right now, everything is going into a database. So we'll have a few thousand people. Mm-hmm. And when my staff starts, we will start from number one and we will, you know, divide up the country. That's how it works. I'll say, you take these states, you take these states, you take these states. And the first few weeks of casting is literally all of us going through and watching every single one of those videos from the beginning. So it doesn't matter when you turn it in. I would tell people, don't wait to the very last minute because that's a pain in the ass for us. And B, you know, it's almost like you have more competition when you're at the very end.
Well, let me play devil's advocate there.
Yeah. Right?
So I don't know. I just did it whenever the open thing was. So this doesn't really apply to what I did. But if I'm the person applying and I'm like, oh, well, I think I'm so great, I'm going to let them pick who they want to pick closer to the end and then be like, we're so close. And then when they're on the edge about who they should pick, then I show up right at the last and be like, yeah, I'm so great. They're going to see mine right at the last. And then they're going to throw me in the mix.
Right. I think... A lot of people do think that. A lot of people will say, I want to be the last person on their brain. So I want to make sure that I am the very last person to apply.
Exactly.
Listen, I understand that. I am telling you honestly, that's not the best way of going about it. Mm-hmm. I mean, we might even watch out of order. Just because you're the very first person to apply doesn't mean that you're going to be the very first person watched. You know, we have a database. Sometimes I might be in the mood to look at girls. So I will push the girls button and all the girls will come up. Sometimes I will want to look at the moms from the Midwest. So I push those buttons. So it's like, first of all, it's all a little out of order how we watch it. It doesn't necessarily mean that we watch them all in order. Mm-hmm. And also, as we're watching, you know, we are remembering people that we love the most. And if we are looking for, it's kind of hard to explain, but if we're looking for, you know, moms, let's say, you know, we really, really want to make sure we have some great moms that we want to take to finals. And as we're going, we're watching, she's a favorite and I love her and she's a favorite. Oh my gosh, she's so funny. And now you come in last, you're kind of competing against all the great ones that we've already seen.
Yeah.
I think it's better to sort of get in at the beginning, be a favorite from the beginning. And now we're comparing everybody to you.
Yeah, you know? and you're growing on them.
I
right?
feel like
they're
yeah,
growing
that's,
on you.
That's that would be what I would do. But I've applied a day before the deadline, not because on purpose, but because I didn't think I could make it. First off,
and how life happened,
and like yeah, just kind of like hey, my mom's like hey, you should apply today, and I was like. All right, you know.
Yeah. But, and listen, a lot of people do apply last minute. I'm not mm-hmm. saying, you know, don't, that doesn't happen because clearly it does.
Yeah.
I'm just saying it makes it easier. I think there's not as much competition for yourself when you sort of get in earlier. We have more time to kind of pick and choose, to look mm-hmm. at you, to think about how you'd fit in the show. And, you know, sometimes when people do this last minute thing, all of a sudden there's a glitch and their camera doesn't work. And oh my gosh. And it's like, you don't know how many emails I get the day after the deadline explaining what went wrong.
Yeah.
And it's like, you had 6 months. I can't help you. You should have tested out your computer or your camera 3 weeks ago. Like, mm-hmm. don't wait till the last minute. And then you have glitches and then, oh, I really wanted my video to be better, but I didn't have time. And it's like, you had 6 months. Like I can't help you with that. So,
what was I going to say? Oh, okay. One, and next time Nicole and I are ever in California, if you would allow us, I would love to sit in one of those video watching sessions and help you decide or pick your brain a little bit, be like, oh, I like that person. But just, I can't imagine what it's like watching those videos, right? Because people really put themselves out there because they're so excited to get on this show. And so mm-hmm. I can't imagine what you see in those videos.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I will tell you that if, I hope you guys do come and I would love to sit and watch some videos with you guys. And I think you will realize that it's easier than you think because of the level of what people put into these things. I mean, I find it so interesting when I look at the application and they say, I have been a super fan for 15 years. I've seen every episode. This is my dream. I love it. And then I click on their video and it's like a 15-second TikTok video that they sent in, you know, that they made for their friends months ago. And their friends think it's hilarious because they're mouthing the words to a song and they're dressed up. And I'm like, why? And this happens all the time, you guys. I'm talking about like Snapchat videos with crazy filters and dog tongues and TikTok. And music. And I get that your friends think those things mm-hmm. are cute and funny because they already know you and they know your personality. And they think, oh my gosh, every one of my friends thinks this is hilarious. So this is what I'm going to send in for Big Brother. They're going to love it. And I look at it and I'm like, I didn't hear their voice. I don't know what they're about.
Because
I know
personality is a big thing in Big Brother. Yes, you can just be like super stunningly beautiful and maybe they feel like, okay, this is when I look my best in this TikTok video. But you have to sell your personality is the most important thing in Big Brother. For sure.
Of course.
Yes.
So you, if you guys came, you would laugh and go, oh my gosh, this is so many people like don't understand their cameras and they're like, they put like a window in front of them and then I can't see their faces mm-hmm. or they're in, you know, a completely dark room and all you see is black or, I mean, there's so many things that people just need to, I mean, if you love the show that much, like take a little bit of pride in your video mm-hmm. and have a time, you know, also other people will send in videos and be like, I have to whisper because my husband's asleep. He's in, and it's like, like, why would you choose that minute? I know I look bad. I just got home from the gym. I just thought that I would do this now without putting on hair and makeup. And it's like, no, you guys, do a place when you could talk and be your actual self and, you know, look cute for your video. And there doesn't have to be any effects. You don't have to spend a ton of time. I still think the best videos are when somebody is just sitting on a couch or a table where they look good and they feel good and they press record and mm-hmm. just talk about things in their life. I like to see you naturally talk. And if your dog jumps on your lap or you knock something over, leave it in. That mm-hmm. shows natural parts of you. We like authenticity. And I remember, Nicole, I remember your video. I remember you being kind of awkward. And, I don't know what I'm saying. And like the camera work wasn't great. Mm-hmm. And but like those awkward moments were very natural. And I could tell the type of person and your personality just from you being like, oh, I don't really know what I'm doing right now, but I'm going to send this in. It's last minute. Like mm-hmm. those are the things we love. You don't have to have special effects. You don't have to have crazy editing.
I was going to say, do some people do too much, like where it's like, okay, this is, oh, it's great, but it's like over edited, like a YouTube video type.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you know, now there's so many YouTubers out there that like the first second you can tell if they're a YouTuber, you know, you can tell it's quick cuts. And you can tell the reactions, and it's like, it's not my favorite thing. Mm-hmm. If we see a video like that and we're still interested, we read the application, they seem interesting, you know, we might call them and say, hey, can you just redo your video with no cuts and just send me something tomorrow? I just want to hear a little about you, you know, because people are very savvy with YouTube looking videos. And I would not say those are always the best representation of yourself.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. And that's the video side. What about the in-person? Cause we have
open call.
Nicole and I, you know, she did the video and I did the open call. So
what? Because I would not have done, let's be honest, Robyn, I would not have been done good in an open call because I'm kind of quiet.
She's
would have
very
been
shy.
Overtaken by all the big personalities. So I do feel like someone has, you need to choose which one might be better for you.
Or what's available. Yeah.
Yeah, totally. I mean, there are pros and cons to both. And a lot of people ask, you know, what's better? What is the better percentage? It doesn't matter. We will watch every single video and we will talk to every single person that comes in. Some people are, they love sort of the camaraderie of the open calls. They love being around people who talk Big Brother. They feel better when they're in person. They feel like, you know, they're actually in front of a casting person and they can impress them. And that might be great for some people. Other people, they get too nervous. It's really uncomfortable. They don't want to be in a situation where they're interviewing with other people. Mm-hmm. They would rather be in a place where they feel good. They can spend a little bit of time thinking about what they want to say. There are pros and cons to both. Mm-hmm. And every season, there are people who are cast both ways. You know, every single season, there are people who sent in videos and there are people who've done open calls. A lot of people like to do both. And that's fine. Okay. If like you said, Vic, if it's accessible and there's an open call around you, feel free. A lot of people will go to the open call and go, ah, I bombed that. I got too nervous. Maybe I'm just going to send in a video now. That's fine. Mm-hmm. Or you send in a video and a month later you go, ah, I hate that I sent that in. I cut my hair. I'm so much cuter now. I want them to see me in person. Fine. Then go to an open call. Mm-hmm. Do whatever you want to do, wherever you are more natural, because the bottom line is the best people are going to shine in either place. Mm-hmm. I really do believe that. And Nicole, you might not have been the person to talk the most, but there might have also been a spark about you that they wanted to learn more. So I do think that wherever you feel more comfortable, definitely go. We take people from both.
Yeah, for sure.
In their open calls, are they a group interview type thing? Oh, I'm curious.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, okay. We usually will bring in like 5 to 6 people at a time. So I will be like at a table and I'll make sort of a semicircle in front of me of 5 people.
Just random people. In
it's
line.
So awkward. Yeah. I will tell you. It's very
some people love it. Some people it's awkward. And every one of, you know, myself and all of our cast, all the casting staff, like we all do it a little bit different. So you can't completely compare. A lot of people will go around and just say, you know, tell me a little about yourself. What would make you a good house guest? And kind of go around in a circle like that. Some people will ask questions related to the game. Some people will ask them to kind of play the game in front of them. You know, I know people have talked about, we might say, okay, you know, the five of you guys just walked in the house right now. and you don't know anything about each other, but you have to, you know, someone has to be the first HOH. Who do you vote for and why? So we'll go around maybe and ask everybody. And it's not, there's no right or wrong answer. Right. We're just looking at people, A, how they go about the game. Mm-hmm. Because if you guys remember on season 10, I believe that's what happened. The house guests walked in. They didn't know anything about each other. They had like sort of a platform and they had to vote on the first HOH, which was Jerry. I know way too much about this, about Big Brother, but without knowing him. And it's like, if you're truly playing Big Brother, you have to have some sort of thought behind it. Why are you voting on this guy? And I love that question at open call because I like to hear what people say. People get nervous and they go, I'll vote for her because she, her hairdo is so cute. It's like, no, you guys, think about the game. Mm-hmm. There's $500,000 at stake. Why are you voting for her? There has to be something more than her hairdo. Mm-hmm. You know, tell me why. So I like people to think about these questions and not just answer it and giggle because you think her hair is cute. You feel like you have a special bonding with her. You feel like you relate to the same way. Maybe you're attracted to her. Like whatever it might be, there should be some reasons behind. As you guys know, everything you do in Big Brother has a consequence. So mm-hmm. I like people to go about those questions as if they're in the house and put some thought into it. And that's what I appreciate at an open call.
No, and I think that's absolutely true. Mm-hmm. And how about those people, like I found myself in that predicament, where you apply, right? You go, you apply, mm-hmm. go to an open call or whatever, or send a video, and then you don't get picked, right?
Right.
So you could just not be ready, right? Or it could just be, you know, this isn't your year, or you didn't mesh well with the people. So what is your recommendation to them? Like, hey, I don't want to apply anymore because...
Yeah, well, you know, Vic, you are the perfect person to talk about this with, you know?
Yeah.
You came out to finals for what season? I don't... 15?
16. Actually, Nicole's 16.
Did you come out for 16?
Yep.
That's funny. So, and I totally remember you, Vic. I remember you being very handsome and very funny. And it was one of those things where you'd leave the room and we would go, I just think he needs just a few more years to figure himself out, you mm-hmm. know? And I know the people who come in and they're so young, that's a very frustrating thing to hear.
Yeah.
That being said, I have a feeling when you came back, you were like, oh, I'm a totally different person than I was mm-hmm. when I applied for 16. Like mm-hmm. I do have life experience. I know myself a little bit better. So I always tell people, if you get through the process and you don't get called back, or you get all the way through the process and maybe you're a semifinalist or you're a finals for the first time, it probably just, you know, a year changes people a lot. So you're not the same person you were a year before. Maybe you've graduated college. Maybe you have a new job. Maybe you've gotten married. Maybe you've gotten divorced. Maybe you have kids. Maybe some sort of tragic event happened in your life. Maybe you traveled out of the country. All of these things change you as a person. And sometimes people just need a little life experience, something a little different in their life to make them a little bit more interesting. And I think that's what happened with you, Vic. We all thought you were great and funny. And sometimes that you're just a little young and we're like, you know what, in a couple of years, that guy is going to be amazing. And that's what happened.
Yeah. And also for those people that do, you know, get it to some point in the process, it's like you come back with that confidence, right? It's like, oh, I made it to this spot before. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm going to crush it this time. Right. I know what to do.
You know what to expect.
I know what to expect. And I'm more relaxed and more confident in myself. And so.
Yeah. And like, you kind of know me already. We've mm-hmm. spent a little bit of time in finals. You know what the room is going to look like. You know that vibe. Because as both of you guys know, that very first time you walk in the interview room is terrifying.
I was sweating every time.
It's terrifying.
I blacked out the second time I had to do that. I was good the first and good the third, thank God. But something happened the second time. I'm like, I don't even remember what just happened.
And that happens all the, listen, you guys. I mean, in my job, it's probably the toughest and most frustrating part, watching somebody who I know would be great for the show and has had great time and go in and blow it. And it's there's nothing you can do to wash away the like butterflies in your stomach. Like, mm-hmm. that's just part of it. But yeah, when you come back the second time, maybe there is a little bit of comfort because at least hopefully, you know, I'm not a scary person.
Yeah.
I'm kind of, you know, the smiling person in the crowd. Mm-hmm. And I am, you know, the cheerleader is what I always say to people going through the process. But as much as I say that and as smiley as I am, I know how scary it is to walk in those interview rooms with executives and try to be on. It's just... It is. I wish there was a freaking pill that I can give everybody to wash the nerves away. But there's really no way around that, unfortunately.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, it was. Nicole and I can both attest. It's very nerve wracking.
I still can't believe that I did it.
Yeah,
I just like can't believe that I handled it.
And it's, I don't know, it's just such an amazing experience all around. Thinking back, I get a little nostalgic. But yeah, it's definitely, if you do get picked to do it, I mean, it's an honor and it's a lot of fun. But speaking about the process itself, can you walk our listeners kind of what the process is for you guys behind the scenes? Because I know we've talked to them a little bit, you know, you do the interviews in your hometown or wherever you're doing it. And then if you get picked, you go to LA and, you know, you have this process. But on your end of things, how does that look for you guys? Because I imagine there's little sleep, a lot of chaos, a lot of looking at pictures, Instagram videos, and, like, all this stuff.
Are you guys also like making last minute changes? Are you still like contemplating because there's like alternatives? Or, like, I'm just so curious if you...
The behind the scenes.
And people dropping out last minute, does that really happen?
Oh, my gosh. Like, you guys, all of those things. It is not... it is definitely not a smooth ride. It never has been for any season. And there are, yes, last-minute dropouts and problems and health issues. And, I mean, all of that comes into play. So, yeah, I mean, we're usually casting, if we're talking about Big Brother, for... I'd say it's about 4 months. And, you know, at the beginning, we figure out when we very first start, it's Christopher. You guys know Christopher.
Yes.
Christopher is my senior producer on Big Brother. So, you know, there's at the beginning, we decide what states we're going to go to, what areas we want to go to. We set all of those open calls up. That takes some time and energy. We start looking through videos. You know, there's thousands of videos at the beginning of Big Brother. So I will have a staff of 10 people in my office for Big Brother. It will be 5 teams of 2. There'll be a producer and an associate for each team. They each get assigned different areas. Everyone will start looking through videos, thousands and thousands of videos.
How many people apply? There.
Yeah.
I mean, it's different every season. It's tough to give a number because it depends on how many open calls we do. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would say, maybe around 15,000 to 20,000.
Wow.
Makes me feel special. It is. It's hard, you know? And you know, when we start day one, there's already probably, you know, 5,000 applicants just sitting in there waiting for us to start. So if you walk in my office the first few weeks, it's not very fun because everybody's just like, has their earphones on and on their computers, and it's just watching videos over hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of videos. And you usually have to watch about 25 videos before you get one that you're like, oh, okay, they're pretty good. And then it's like back to like TikTok and then back to... So from there, and at the same time, we're traveling around the country and we're going to open calls. So we are deciding who our semi-finalists are, either from video submissions or from the open calls. The people who were interested in hearing more, they get semi-final interviews. And those are one-on-one interviews, and they could either be in person or through Skype. Thank God for Skype, which has made our lives so much better. You know, what's funny is if you guys back in like seasons, you know, 2 through, maybe even like 8, people would send in VHS videos.
I was going to ask you how like the interview or like how the submissions have changed since.
Oh my God.
How do you even file that?
Yeah. So we had, you know, I have been looking everywhere. I used to have pictures and I don't know where they are of what our what our space looked like when it came up to the deadline, because we would have, you know, a PA go to like our PO box every day and bring back videos.
We'd
all just sit around and like open them up, take the applications out, watch the VHS video.
That's awesome.
During the like deadline part, like that last week, we would have truckloads. We would go down with like two or three trucks, fill them up with these envelopes and VHS videos. So, I mean, yes, our lives have been much easier now with Skype, and it makes the travel and everything much easier. Yeah. So the semifinal interviews, you know, people probably do their best in the semifinal interviews because it's just you and a producer. I feel like all the producers who work for me, you know, they're
this
cool.
This is like the Skype interview you're talking about. That's called semifinal. Okay. Before they fly you out.
Exactly. Yeah. So you'll do either a Skype or an in-person. If you get an in-person interview, like if you live in LA, you'll probably come in person. Or if you did, if we flew to your area, you went to an open call. Sometimes we do in-person interviews like the day after.
Yeah, that's what I did. Yep.
And even people who go to open calls, if you don't get that in-person, don't freak out. Just means we're going to come back and we'll be Skyping more people. So, it's just like time slots. Sometimes we will see 15 to 20 in person a day. And if there's 40 people we want to call back, we'll just go back and we'll Skype them.
I Skyped with Jesse and he liked me, which I'm so grateful for. So do some casting people who work for you, do they have like a tendency to like certain people? Like was Jesse my soul, like if he didn't like me, was I just dead in the water at that point?
I mean, well, here's what happens. I mean, from there, then they pitch all their people to me.
Okay.
So not all of their people, their favorite people. And a lot of people will be like, they might come in and go, listen, I can't, like I'm on the fence with this person. What do you think of them? Okay. And we'll play a little bit. I'll ask some questions. We'll talk about it. So they're kind of the first barrier to get to me. And then everybody will pitch their favorites to me. From there, we will narrow those down and we'll pitch those people to Allison and Rich. We have kind of like a big room and a big monitor. We play videos. They ask questions about you guys. We have your applications. We talk about them. So it's a big, it's kind of a, you know, obviously it's a big process. You've gone through a lot of people by the time we choose you to come to finals.
Oh, that's awesome.
So it's not just like, it's not just one person. Yeah. I mean, listen, Jesse could love you and I could love you and Allison Rich could be like, nah. No.
So everyone has to pretty much like, if you're going to LA, you have like, they have put a lot of time in knowing who you are and what they're expecting of you.
Yes. Every single person. And you know, the taboo word of recruiting, which is one of my favorite things to talk about, those people go through the same process. It just means that someone in the staff maybe has seen them somewhere and asked them to apply. They've gone through their semifinal interview. They're pitched to me. And listen, when these people are pitched to me and when they're pitched to Allison and Rich, I don't care where they come from. I don't care if they're a recruit. I know people think, oh, if they're recruited, then they're automatically in. No, because when they're pitched to Allison and Rich, there isn't a gold star that says recruit. You know, it's just they're pitched with a big group of people. And once they're in the process, they're in the process. It's not like a special place that recruits go. They go in the process like everybody else. And a lot of recruits get through the process and get all the way to finals and don't get on the show, just like regular people who apply. And so I say you have to go through the process. Yeah.
And I say like as a game, like a fan of the show, I'm grateful for the recruits in the house because you feel like you have a little bit of a leg up. So I think even for the game to happen kind of how it needs to, you can't have everyone being like a Dan Giesling and just going like hard in the paint.
Or a super fan, you know, like somebody that doesn't know how to play makes it better.
They have an idea, but it also makes the game more interesting because they act out. They're honestly more entertaining. I'm just going to say
course.
That.
Listen, I couldn't agree with you guys more. I mean, obviously every fan has their, you know, reason to what would make the best show. And I think the best show, what I always say, is a mixture of super fans, casual fans and newbies. And that's what makes the show interesting and messy and people do things that they're not supposed to do. If it was a house of super fans, every person would lay low at the beginning.
Exactly.
And we would have, no one would want to get in anyone's face. We wouldn't have any fights. We wouldn't have any crazy moments. It would be a lot of people not wanting to get under anybody else's skin until the right time. And I mean, I just feel, and a lot of people, it'd be a lot of people sitting around thinking about what competition is next and who did it best. And I'm going to, and it's like, no, it's better to have a few people who don't know what the heck is going on.
Exactly.
And that's what makes it interesting, you know?
Because like on 16, Joey, she was all of a sudden day two making an all-girls alliance, and then she turned into an alter ego named Alex and put a beard on. And I was like, thank you. It was so entertaining, but I was like, thank you, Joey, because I will not be the first one out of the house now. But it just makes for, you know, you just look around at that point, you're like, wow, I'm really in the Big Brother house, and wow, this stuff really does happen, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. That's so funny. You want me to go on or you go?
Take it through.
I mean, I could do this forever, so I'll try to kind of wrap it up from there. You know, we choose our finalists, there's no really set number, but I would say we bring out under 100 people from all of the people who have applied. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you guys know it better than anybody that the finals process is really fun and really exciting and terrifying and weird. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we lock you in your rooms. You're pretty much sequestered. You can't talk to other people. We have, handlers who walk you from place A to place B. Mm-hmm. You go through, you know, usually a few interviews with us, with myself and the producers. And each interview, there might be more people in that room, more executives there. While you're doing that, you're also going through psych evaluations. You have the MMPI, which is a psych test that you guys take that takes fucking forever, right?
Yeah, I had to take that thing 3 times.
And you go through a medical check. And while all that's happening, they're checking. You have a background check that you're going through. Mm-hmm. And now these past few years, social media scrubs, which are scary and take out a lot of people, unfortunately. And, you know, through that process, a lot of people are taken out of the process, which is a huge bummer for us. Sometimes our favorite people are taken out of the process from one of these other things, background checks, social media, psych, medical. And I couldn't even tell you exactly why, you know, all that stuff is confidential. The doctors don't even tell us.
Right.
So they might come to us and say, we have to take so-and-so out. And I mean, I don't even know why they were taken out or what the reason is. But I have to listen to the professionals. They have to sign off on all these people. And, you know, and you guys know from there, it's more interviews. And yeah, the cast isn't locked until the last minute. There's last minute changes. People drop out. I mean, I had somebody, I can't remember which season it was. A guy was sequestered to go in the house. It was like day two of sequester, and he like missed his family too much and cried and wanted to go home.
I mean, that was season 16, I think.
it's happened more than once. This has happened, these things, but I mean, I think, and you guys know, That sequester before you move in the house is probably the toughest part of the entire show.
I think I've watched movies than I've ever had in my life. Yeah.
You're lonely. You're overthinking everything. You have no idea if you've done the right thing. You haven't talked to your family. You haven't talked to anybody. And people second guess it. And, oh my gosh, I don't think this is the right time for me. I miss my family. I miss my kids. I mean, we have to be prepared for all of that. And I never want to talk somebody into.
I was just going to ask, do you try to be like, no, you're fine. Like, just get back in there.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I will definitely talk to people. Don't get me wrong. When they are having second thoughts and stuff. And some of them are easier than others. I mean, I don't think it's any secret that Derek was one of the people to back out. And I know him and I have talked about it before, and I got on the phone, and it wasn't me like begging him, because I don't ever want someone to go in the house who truly doesn't want to go in.
Yeah.
I think it's up to me to figure out if I know they really want to go in, but they're freaking out, then let's talk through it. And that was definitely what was happening with Derek. He was freaking out. He was thinking about missing his daughter and his wife and what happens with work and all, I mean, all these things. And he pulled out. I remember right before it came out, I remember having a long talk with him. But again, I don't want to put someone in that house where they're second. Like, the most important thing for me is when you go in that house, the only thing that should be on your mind is the game. Yeah. I don't want you thinking about paying your bills. I don't want you thinking about my dad is in the hospital. I don't want you like all of that stuff has to be put aside and the game has to be the most important. So a lot of that time beforehand, whether it's myself or Sean, who I know you guys know very well.
Mama Bear. Yeah.
Mom, yeah, I love Sean. Thank God for Sean. She made me feel so like... Like she was like, yes, just like my mom in there and just like, are you okay? Yes, I'm okay. Yeah. Thank you.
She is the calming one for sure. She has a very difficult job, but you know, it's important for all of us, Allison, Rich, producer Sean, myself, that when you guys go in, all the other stuff, your worries, you know, Sean is going to help you get your bills paid, talk to your parents, make sure your family's okay. And producers just want your head in the game. And that's really important.
Yeah, no, for sure. Okay, and also, do you still have like audition tapes of people who sent them in? Like, would you have mine?
Gosh.
This is so random. I don't have it anymore, but I just think it'd be hilarious to like show my kids someday or just have.
The one that you applied with or your interview? I might, you know, we have a new database now. I have to think of when... We started the, like definitely over the last few years, everything is saved, obviously. Oh, okay. You know what? I wish I could find the freaking VHSs of all the.
Yes, that would be so awesome. You could do like, they could, CBS could honestly do a commercial with them. You know, that would look so cool of like the audition commercial, like showing.
That would be amazing. Oh, I know that they have like storage somewhere. I would have, I think Don Wallman has the key to that storage space from like 20 years ago. Maybe Nicole, you know, let me, when we're done, I will, I'll go on my computer and I'll see if I have either of yours on my computer. So I'll send them to you guys. I'm not sure whose I have. And for it just obviously, you guys know there's so many.
I can't even imagine that you would have it.
I can't imagine how much you pay for data storage.
Yeah, it's in there. You know, I would have. Let me go back and look because I'm trying to think of what season we started with this database. It might have been after 16. I'm not sure, but I'll go back and I'll look and I'll let you know if I have it.
That's interesting. is there anything else that you want to tell our listeners or future possible big? Oh, one, I think it'd be if in the years that Nicole and I have kids, I don't know if they'll ever apply to be on Big Brother or anything like that, but that'd be hilarious.
What, our kids?
Yeah.
Well, if it's still season 50 or something,
yeah,
or
hilarious. What?
I mean, I hope to not be, you know, alive by the time that could happen, but if I happen to be, and it would be like, you know, the Riley kids and then like Jess and Cody's kid, Maverick, like all the little kids will be in there. That would be amazing.
Jeff and Jordan.
Yeah, that'd be hilarious.
Brittany. Daddy, well, dog. I guess Brittany still can come. I mean, she's awesome. She has the cutest little girls. They can come too. That would
they
be hilarious.
The they are sassy just like mom.
Yes. She said they already are getting her facial expressions and I'm like, yes, good.
That's amazing. That's amazing. That's so funny.
Is there anything you want to leave a potential Big Brother applicants? Any words of wisdom, encouragement, advice?
My words of wisdom would be, I'm trying so hard not to say be yourself because I know how much people hate that. You know, I would say go in and just don't overthink it. That's what I always tell people. Like, don't, especially if you're going to an open call, don't overthink everything you want to say in front of us. It will end up coming out very canned and we can tell when you are saying the words that you know you wanted to say in front of us. Like, And even when you're doing your video, don't write out a script. If you want to do maybe bullet points to remind yourself of things you want to touch, that is the best thing to do. You know, when you come to any semifinals or final situation, don't censor yourself. Don't overthink it. You want to try to have a natural conversation like you would with anybody. I mean, the thing for us is we want to see what you're going to be like on day 12 in the house. Once you've forgotten about all of the like, holy shit, Big Brother, I'm mm-hmm. here moments, and you're just chatting with people and having a conversation, that is the person we want to see from the beginning. So, you know, that is my advice. And I know it's kind of tough advice and it's confusing advice. And if you're confused, then show it when you're doing your audition. You're allowed to say these things. You're allowed to tell us that you're nervous and you're confused. It's okay. Those are real moments. Mm-hmm. And if you love the show and you think you'd be good on it, apply. That's what I would say. There's so many people who love to tell me what I've done wrong and they hate this and that. And then I'll be like, well, did you apply? No, I wouldn't apply because I would never get cast. Well, you don't know that until you apply. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter where you live. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter your background. Just go out and apply. If you don't make it this year, try out next year. And anybody I know will plug these things, but follow me on social media mm-hmm. at casting, K-A-S-S-T-I-N-G. I always talk about open calls. And any shows on Big Brother, any shows on CBS, you can always go to cbs.com/casting. That's with the C, C-A-S-T-I-N-G. And you can apply for Big Brother. You can apply for Survivor. You can apply for Love Island.
Oh, yeah. We should talk about, let's talk a little bit about Love Island.
Yeah.
So I love season one of Love Island. I had never seen it before. And it was, because it's in, what country is it in?
It's in Fiji.
Okay. No, but isn't there like an Australian version or something?
Yeah, I mean, it's all over the place. It's in the UK, in Australia, they shoot in Fiji.
Okay, so this is, I saw it and I was so hooked. I was like, oh my God, this is so good. So let's talk about that. So, because our listeners could be looking for love on an island.
Yeah.
Are you looking for with that?
I will, like, sort of the big sell for us and why I'm so happy it came back for a second season is mm-hmm. it's not like a malicious show. It's not a show where we're looking for people who are like, want to snatch other people's men and women and want to get in people's faces. There's not a lot of drama.
And originally, that's what I thought it would be, was like, oh my gosh, they're going to be catty and steal. But they were so nice to each other.
Yes, I know. I think that, and that's sort of the format that's come from the UK of you as a viewer, you sort of want to watch it. And yes, like it's beautiful people mm-hmm. and it's in Fiji, but you sort of want to watch and be like, I want to hang with those girls. Mm-hmm. Like I want to be one of those guys. They're fun. They're cool. Mm-hmm. They support each other. And it's been sort of an easier sell for us on the casting side that we're not looking necessarily for people who want to go in and stir the pot and get rid of people and, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. sleep with somebody else's guy. Like it really is a fun, loving place. And you know, that might not be for everybody. It might be a little slow paced for some people, people who watch, you know, Bachelor in Paradise and maybe there's more crying. Mm-hmm. But it really is a show where the girls support the girls, the guys support the guys.
So you cast that people on purpose. You're casting.
Yes.
Okay.
Of course.
So I didn't know if it was like, wow, they're just all really nice people or if it just happened to be like, I thought you guys would maybe want stealing and stuff, and when it wasn't like that, I was like, thank God, because I would just I would feel so bad for if that was me, you know, putting
I sort of love the show that I really think it concentrates more on the relationships and finding people that you connect with more than the drama of the dating world. And listen, that comes with it. There's going to be drama.
Sure.
I'm sure everything is not going to be drama free, but what I would rather cast people who want to have a great experience and find someone they connect with. I would rather cast those people than people who are like, I just want to go in there and steal someone's man. Like that's not what this show is. Mm-hmm. So,
and
yeah, it was, so it's,
Sorry.
It's sweet. No, I was just saying, it's like, it's a sweet show. It's really cute.
And it was successful with couple ratings. I see a lot of them are still together. Like,
yes, I know. That's crazy. And the couple that everyone was talking about, Kira and Cashel, they're back together. Like, they broke up and now they're back together, which makes me happy.
I love them. Yeah.
The winning couple, I know you guys talked to Elizabeth and Zach, they're still together. So, yeah. I mean, listen, they're young on this show, so I don't know if we'll see marriages out like Big Brother, but maybe.
And old do you have to be to apply for that show for Love Island?
It's 18 and up.
Okay.
But you know, 18, 19, 20, all the way through the 20s. I mean, everybody is able to apply, but we definitely want you to be able to fit in with the rest of the cast. Like, I probably will not cast a 36-year-old guy with a bunch of 18-year-old girls. That would not or vice versa. That would probably not be the best show to cast. But yeah, I mean, if you're single and it's obviously it's in some beautiful tropical location and it gets a little silly, which I like. There's silly games, kind of like Big Brother almost in there. So anybody who wants to apply for any CBS shows, cbs.com/casting, and that will take you to any of the CBS shows that are casting now.
Awesome.
Well, hey, thank you so much. We're finally happy to have you on this show. It was a great conversation and we do miss you. So
I know. Thank you for having me, you guys. I love talking to you guys. I love seeing what you're both doing. Vic, I'm so proud of you.
Thank you.
And, you know, not only the physical transformation, but the life transformation is super exciting. And I love you guys and I miss you guys too.
Thank you so much. We'll see you soon enough. I'm sure something will bring us to California for something. Yes. And if we are in the area, we'll make sure to stop by the office again.
You guys stop by. And I'm going to look for your video applications now.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you so much. You have a good rest of your day.
I love you guys. Bye. Happy holidays.
Love you. Happy holidays.
All right. Bye.
Bye, guys.
We really hope you guys enjoyed
Robyn Kass.
Hopefully she finds that video for you. That'd be awesome to see. And hopefully she may, if she has some video of me, that'd be awesome as well.
Yeah. If she does find it, I will post it. So we'll all be entertained.
Yeah. I'm excited to see that. So now we're going to transition. We'll do your part first.
Okay. Weird or normal.
So we haven't got that down pat yet. That was a test and we're not going to use that one moving forward.
Okay. Is it weird or normal to pour your milk before your cereal?
To pour your milk before your cereal. So you're saying you put the milk in first and then the cereal after?
Yeah. Do you do that?
No. 100% no. I put the cereal in first and then I pour the milk after.
Well, honestly, I do too. But I know people that do pour milk in first.
Yeah. So this was this weird or normal. We've been picking them up from our listeners. Mm-hmm. You know, so we really encourage you guys to
So
throw those in
because we already exposed a lot of our weirdness, and now we're like trying to figure out everyone else's weirdness.
But no, it's a 100% weird because okay, my thing is how do I know how much milk I'm gonna need?
But at the same time, if you put your milk in the bowl, how much cereal do you need?
Okay, but I put the cereal in knowing how much.
Does it really matter is what I'm saying. Does it matter if you put your milk in first?
Yes, because then it reduces how much cereal you can put in, right? To effectively fill yourself. I mean, all I know is I don't need a lot of cereal these days. But when I did eat cereal, I would fill up my bowl to the top. Sometimes I would get a popcorn bowl. Sometimes it was really bad.
Ew.
Sometimes I'd get a popcorn bowl because I ate that much cereal and I'd just dump it in and then just splash a bunch of milk in there.
I can just see you scooping it up like your salad bowls.
Oh, so bad.
But I think like what I'm trying to say here is that it doesn't really matter.
It does matter though.
So I don't really like a lot of milk with my cereal, so I would be fine with putting half a cup of milk in a bowl and then adding my cereal. Yeah,
okay, so this is why I think it matters. So when you put milk into the bowl and then you put cereal in the bowl, it's like the cereal floats on top of it. And then you got to then push the cereal down with your spoon.
It does make more sense to do vice versa.
It just makes it more of like a task does to anybody eat that cereal.
Let us know if you like pour your milk first.
Okay, but okay, let me preface it with this.
Okay.
I would understand if the person that likes to eat their cereal really crunchy and just likes a hint of milk
exactly.
with their cereal to pour in their milk first and then the cereal on top and then just start eating.
Yeah.
Because I pour, and we've already had this discussion, but I pour my cereal and then pour my milk, let it sit for a minute, right? Mm-hmm. And I constantly press it down so everything gets a little soggy and then I start eating.
Yeah. So for me, who I don't like hardly any milk in my cereal, I would be fine doing it this way. I'm going to try it.
And also, I would have a question for the person that submitted this. Do you drink your milk after you eat the cereal?
Mm.
Do you, Nicole? No, you don't.
It depends. If there's a little, yes. I don't like milk. I don't even really like almond milk. I don't like liquids that I can't see through because it kind of makes them think like there's like snot in them or something.
So, like, okay, wait, like, time out. I don't understand this rationale.
Like alcohol, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I barely drink,
mm-hmm.
but anything that's creamy alcohol makes me want to vomit.
Like rum chata?
Yeah, rum chata doesn't taste bad, but when you look at it and think about it, it's gross.
So because you can't see through it and it's kind of like creamy.
Like you don't know what's in there.
Huh.
I don't like creamy things. I really don't.
I just learned something new about you.
I like see-through liquids.
Yeah.
They seem cleaner.
I don't get that.
It's a texture thing, maybe.
Yeah, it could be a texture. So,
I'm
like,
not a
milk
person at
all. So, like, creamer in your coffee.
Creamer is an exception.
You see, like, I
do. Okay, until I met you, I drank my coffee black.
And I did you a favor. You're welcome.
No, you didn't.
It's the God's it's nectar.
It's way worse for you.
But it tastes way better.
I don't know. I don't.
I don't know. Anyway, I think it's weird to add milk before the cereal. Okay.
Mm-hmm. If I seen someone doing it, I'd question it.
Okay, Nicole. So, Spanish word of the day.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
You're going to get it. It's so easy. So easy, anybody can get it.
I hate when you say that. What is it?
So, the Spanish word of the day is leche.
Oh, milk.
Whoa.
Yeah, I know
How'd
that.
How'd you know that one?
I'm not dumb.
What do you mean? It doesn't even sound like milk.
Okay, that was something I learned in Spanish class. Congratulations of taking episode 47, and you're finally making a word that I learned in Spanish class in high school. Yes, all those flashcards I memorized.
I am so surprised because I've said words before that sound similar to the English word.
Yeah.
This one doesn't sound anything like milk.
No.
And you got it.
Yeah, because it's common.
Wow, I am
surprised.
You're not
saying all these funky words.
Wow. You know what? I am impressed.
Thank you.
Can you say it?
Leche?
Leche.
Leche.
Yeah.
There's like an accent over the last E, right? Or is it the second E? First E, I mean.
I think it's, I don't know.
I think it's
You know, that's something that I have to work on because I didn't learn Spanish in school and therefore I don't know all the proper like accent marks and all that stuff in writing, right? I can get by and I can write everything out without the accents and people know what you're saying, right?
If you
write it, like if they read it, they'll
but
know.
But you went to Puerto Rico and you had to go to college. So didn't you have to write papers?
Yes, University of Puerto Rico. Yes, I did. And I got marked on my papers a lot, right?
Could you like just type them into Word and they wouldn't fix it for you?
Yeah, they'll fix it for you.
Yeah, so that makes more sense. Mm-hmm. They'll put the accents and stuff.
Exactly. And now, like we always do, because you guys are so awesome.
You guys are awesome. This is almost a year, like a couple weeks shy. Well, I guess this is episode week 47, so we're 5 weeks so shy.
It's crazy, though.
But we have stayed at five stars, you guys. Thank you so much for all of your nice reviews. I never in a million years would have imagined us sitting at 5 stars for even 47 weeks. That makes me so happy.
Yeah.
It makes me feel good. And every time I go look, there's more 5-star reviews.
Look, I don't know what constitutes a successful podcast, mm-hmm. but you guys have made it a success. And we really do appreciate that. We do I'd say more so now Nicole does, because I'm not here, but we are putting a lot of hard work, time, and effort
into
this.
When we do something, we don't half-butt it.
Yeah,
we go all the way.
But none of that would matter if it weren't for you guys.
Yeah, if you guys weren't listening, then
I couldn't do it. So.
Exactly. And so, no, we really do appreciate it. And because of that, that's why we read these reviews. So, Nicole, take it away.
Okay, this one's from Running Kate. Love, 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 5 stars. This one sounds familiar to me. Are you sure I didn't read it before?
Just go for it if we did. I mean, I don't know. We'll just go with it.
Okay. I love the dynamic between Victor and Nicole. Their chemistry is so obvious. I truly feel like I'm sitting down with two of my friends. They aren't putting on a show or forcing anything. They are just entertaining because of who they genuinely are. While this podcast is very casual and easy to listen to, I was surprised by how professional they are with guests. They never talk over people or dominate conversations. They do a great job of leading the conversation, asking interesting questions, and giving their guests a chance to be heard. I just can't say enough good things about Victor and Nicole, both as podcasters and as people. I'm rooting for them in all aspects of life, and I'm excited to see what the future holds for them as they become a family. No, I haven't read this one before. That's so sweet.
Aw, yeah, that is really sweet.
Thank you so much.
I really appreciate that. Thank you so much. And mine is really short, sweet, and to the point.
Okay.
And it's really nice. It's called Frick Your...
Oh, I love this one.
Frick You're Too Cute by Sunny D. Nicole, I shave my toes as well.
Victor!
I love that you guys are so real. It's adorable heart.
You just wanted to say that I shave my toes again. But I loved, you know, I loved the title of it.
Yeah. God, that was funny. I got tears in my eyes. I was waiting to read that.
You're
I was
ridiculous.
Like, oh, this is going to be great.
Oh, Victor.
Oh, you know what I didn't tell you? When the lady cut my hair today, and she may or may not have messed up the back.
She did.
She also asked me if she should trim my eyebrows because, and I was like, why? Is there something wrong with my eyebrows? She's like, well, some of them are long. So I let her trim my eyebrows. And I don't know if you noticed. Or if she messed that up too.
I didn't notice your haircut a little bit, but it's okay.
Thank you. No, it'll
grow back.
You only
graduate in a couple of days.
I'll have a cover on when I graduate, so that'll be fine. But anyway, thank you guys so much. Don't forget to rate, review, and subscribe. The easiest way is that little purple app on your phone. That's the Apple Podcast. And you can listen anywhere you listen to podcasts. So Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher. And you can always go to www.cococalientepodcast.com. And you can also check out our merchandise there. We got the new mugs, the new shirts.
Yeah, there's more coming. And also, if you order
this week...
There's
more coming?
Yes. more long sleeve. We sold out long sleeve in 24 hours.
The
only
reason I say that is because it does cost us money. And then Nicole does ship and package it all. And it takes up real estate in our house. So I'm like, oh, we got more. Great.
But you would still be able to get them for Christmas because we use priority shipping. So 2 to 3 days, you get it. And
awesome.
I ship out that day. So...
Yeah, and don't forget to follow us at Coco Caliente Podcast on Instagram and Coco Caliente Pod on Twitter.
And we are doing giveaways right now on our podcast page, so check those out.
Yes, we are. Thank you. Hope you guys enjoyed.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Stop.
Thanks.
Victor, stop.